Good morning to you and welcome to Asakia Online. My name is Nelson Ndebele and this is the Breakfast Club. It's a Monday morning and there's a lot that has happened during the weekend, so I hope that the Hambile Church and your favorite team won. Kulababa is the way you are tough luck. Try next time. As usual, we'll start by checking at the news headline, a few things that are going on, and then after that, we'll just have a discussion. And today, we'll be talking to Efinube on the issue of Ubukhosi in the crown with Hamanjani in this Indaba Yoguti, Ubukhosi, Napa, Mandevele. So we'll be hearing from him and what they've done, the challenges that they faced, and the preparations to the installation of the king. Just to look at the news headlines, I mean, one of the things that people are talking about on social media and even in the news headlines is the issue of the deal that was started sometime during, 2016-2017. The much awaited trains from South Africa finally arrived over the weekend. Total was about 7 locomotives, 108 wagons, and 5 passenger coaches are expected in Bulawayo this week. This is part of the 400 million deal which was signed between Transnet, which is a South African company, and a group of individuals, Zimbabweans, called Diaspora Infrastructure Development Group. You know, these wagons basically are being leased from Spornet, which is part of Transnet. And this week, around Friday, the President of the Republic, Emmerson Mnangagwa, is expected to, you know, commission these locomotives and the wagons. There have been a lot of discussion, a lot of talk, a lot of arguments about this deal. Some people saying that Abasiniki Stimele Zindala, some people saying after only railway line, Mele Sifile, why did they start there? But I mean, I think that it's a positive move if there is investment that is going on, and basically I think it's something that is happening, because everyone agrees that NRZ has been a big company in Zimbabwe. It employed a lot of people, and if there is any method of reviving it, I think it's better. I mean, railway line revival, why bring antiques to Zimbabwe? NRZ is not a museum. That's one tweet that I saw.
Well, I think it's a lost point when people talk about how old the train is, instead of focusing on the opportunity that we have to research the company and through NRZ to research the economy itself. So for me, it is important that they start anyway. Whether they start with the trains, they start with the way, the discussion is neither here nor there. What is important is that at least there is an activity that is directed at getting the National Railways of Zimbabwe to work, and by extension to get the economy to work.
Yes, I'm still on that note. The President of Zimbabwe, Emmerson Mnangagwa, is expected in Botswana today on a two-day state visit after he was invited by the President of that country, Lieutenant General Sibeze Kama Yenkama. He's one of the guys with a long title. You know, maybe it's because he's a soldier, he likes so many titles. But it's, I mean, during Mugabe's times, relationships, our relationship with Botswana was kind of like not really nice. And this time around, the president is there, two-day visit. They're expected to talk bilateral relations, revive talks on trade and so forth. And I guess they're also going to talk about the Inkomozeti. You know, as people come from Plumtree, Inkomozeti and Botswana, they have to choose Botswana. And all those kinds of things. But do you think this is the beginning of good things for Zimbabwe, where we actually have good relations with our neighbors? Because the issue of Zimbabwe and Botswana at one point really was not that good.
Yeah, it is important that all the countries that surround us have a good relationship with us, but it takes us to initiate those relationships. You know that the deterioration in terms of those relationships was because of the demise of democracy in Zimbabwe, the erosion of the rule of law, successive rigged elections or claimed rigged elections, a declining economy, the massive influx of Zimbabweans into our neighbors, and a number of other things. So it takes Zimbabweans, the Zimbabwean leadership, to really begin to engage the government of Botswana, the government of South Africa, of Zambia, of Namibia, of Mozambique, the African continent and beyond, to so that we are able at the end of the day to build an economy that works for the people of Zimbabwe. Because without good neighbors, without good relations with your neighbors, there is no economy that you can build. There is no country that can live as an island. We need relations, we need neighbors, we need people, we need friends in order to succeed in whatever we desire to succeed in.
And lastly, looking at the headlines, the MDC Alliance, the rally in Masvingo this weekend, the rally was addressed by Chamisa, BT, Welshman Mube, and that rally, Chamisa said, the squabbles within the MDC or the fight for power on who's the president and who's the acting president is going to be resolved this week. We realized that Elias Mzuri was there, he was not given a chance, and Togo Zangupi was nowhere near the rally. The issue of the MDC and the constitution, really, I find it serious. How did these guys find themselves in such a mess? Was it going to be better if they properly followed their constitution in terms of who is the president, who is the vice, who takes over, all those kind of things? The appointment of the other two really messed up everything.
Yeah, it did. The appointment of the two vice presidents went against the constitution. Every constitutional scholar will tell you that even if the constitution does provide for the president to appoint additional executive officers of a political party or government, it doesn't mean those are going to be equal to those that are elected in a Congress in this case. It is only towards an who was elected in a Congress, and the two vice presidents were appointed. And to the extent that the party constitution is followed, it falls into place automatically if you take Togo Zanikope instead of taking Chamisa and Elias Mzuri. So they are messing up their own political party, and that would get them to really into a mess at the end of the day. What one needs to do is always to practice what you preach. If you expect ZANU-PF and the government of Zimbabwe to abide by constitutional ethos, you have to begin to do so yourself. You have to practice, you have to live the constitutionalism that you preach. You have to live the constitutional principles that you ask others to live by.
Some people have said this is because Togo Zangupi is from Matabeleland, and others say that this is because Togo Zangupi is a woman. So why do you think we ended up having this situation?
It's both. It's both, and in addition to the two, that she comes from Matabeleland, as well as the fact that she is a woman. It is also an issue of the fact that we have grown up under ZANU-PF government, where the rule of law doesn't matter. We attack it left, right, and center. This is an attack on the rule of law by the MDC itself. And it calls into question their ability to govern properly in terms of the principles of the rule of law. If they cannot abide by their own constitution, if they cannot respect their own constitution, the issue of gender equality is also really under attack. When we raise women only to the extent that they become vice presidents, we raise the people of Matabeleland only to the extent that they become vice president, and beyond that there is this class ceiling. Really, we cannot sustain this as a country. We need to change it. It has to be possible and simple for the people of Matabeleland to rise up to the highest levels in the country. It has to be possible and easy for women to rise up to that level. No one has told me that Chamisa is more competent than Togo Zangupi, or Mzuri is more competent than Togo Zangupi. No one has at least made the case for that. They only tell me that Chamisa is more popular, and I don't know how they've tested that. But I guess it is up to the MDC to really sort this out.
Yeah, quite an interesting weekend. We're going to see whether the squabbles are going to be solved, but also looking forward to the president coming to Bulawayo. And of course, we expect him to talk about the revival of the industries in Bulawayo and many other issues that affect Bulawayo. So it's part of his 100-day, I think, to say he needs to do something. So that was our news headline in brief with Ubabungu. But then back to our issue of the day. Umube Lapu Efi is the CEO of the Crown Council. So tell us briefly about the Crown Council. Yanzani, who is was part of this Crown Council, what are its objective or aims?
There are two key provisions in the Constitution that necessitated the formation of the Crown Council. The first one is where the Constitution says the chiefs must promote the cultural traditions and practices of the communities which they serve. The second one is that the chiefs must take measures to preserve cultural traditions and heritage of the communities from which they come. And generally, it is accepted by every person that one of the key institutions of our history and heritage is that of the king, the kingship. So in 1997, the chiefs, 7 November 1997, came together and agreed that it was important that we resuscitate or revive the kingship in this region, which last saw its day on 4 December 1893. So the work was done until 19 August 2017, when the Crown Prince was announced, and then the chiefs came together to establish the Crown Council for purposes of coordinating the work around the revival of the kingship itself. So it is composed of the chiefs from across the region, in the Matabeleland South, North, and the Midlands, and the chiefs that are relevant to the culture that are located beyond the Matabeleland and Midlands regions. It crosses over to Manika and Chief Kwekube and others, basically for purposes of coordinating the resuscitation of the king.
Yeah, I think this is one of the issues that everyone has been talking about, and this is a school of course now. Yeah. We're talking about power, we're talking about the revival of the kingship, which I mean has not been there for the, I think, 124 years. So one of the issues that has been always been controversial is how do you trace back to the person who's supposed to be the king. We've seen a number of groups actually claiming to be the rightful heirs to that. But before we get to those and say what process was followed to then say this is the right guy for the, I mean, then maybe to say for the avoidance of doubt, we are talking about, you know, actually you guys are working towards the installation of the king.
Yeah, sure. The starting point is to agree that you are starting where the last king left. So you are starting with King Lobengwana, and you say that his disappearance or his death, who was the person most qualified amongst his offspring to take over the throne? And basically, there are key principles in what is known in the Ndebele as Inkosi Zala Inkosi that was operating there. The first principle is that the person who qualifies, for the person to qualify, their mother must have been married to a king. In other words, if your mother was married to a prince, and you, even if you were born after your father had become a king, you do not qualify. That is the first principle. I must emphasize, you must have been born to a mother who got married to a king, a person who was already in the throne. Secondly, you must yourself have been born after your father naturally had been king. So those are two regulating principles in this instance. So they go back to King Lobengwana and they look, who were the sons that were born prior to him becoming the king? Those are ruled out automatically. Or alternatively, even if you were born after your father had become the king, if your mother got married to your father before your father became the king, you are ruled out automatically. And then you are left with a few people that then the eldest among those is the one who becomes the heir to the throne. And starting with the people immediately, the offspring of King Lobengwana, because they did not take up the throne themselves. Once you identify the person who was supposed to take up the throne there, then you follow the lineage to the person who is available today. In other words, that is just the chain.
Yeah, Gulabanyabatumana, yes, Kapilobengwana, the Bale,
I'm sure the outcomes will be usual this week or last week, Leon Kosa. I don't want to say it is an invention. I think these are people of integrity who believe that they are right. But it means we have to completely rewrite our history, ban on artistic groups, and start from squares. And given the fact that you are saying there was a king between 1896 and 1929, that is 33 years of reign, and that person is unknown. It cannot be located in history as king. It's very difficult for people to pick that and take it as something that is serious. But I think it's something to be debated. On our part, we are very serious. So we are very consistent in terms of the history of this project. We are starting where King Lobulamula left, and we have counted, researched, done all our work, and found that it was supposed to be Prince Jube who was supposed to take over, and he was subsequently exiled into South Africa. Again, his offspring were kept outside the country, and we have managed to track those people and find the rightful heir to the throne. So we are very, very serious on that one.
So the Kumaotigona, the rightful throne, as in the Kumaotigona, the prince, Collins, Lord Mulan, Kumar. And the Mundo, if you say Mundo was exiled in South Africa, that means the guy who has never been president of Zuma. It's a guy who doesn't know, maybe that's how Zimbabwe looks like. But how could you talk about it? But then how do you then bring this guy here and he becomes the king of Abanta Wazama, Kula Nawa, Wazimu, to see what I would enjoy, Ibadla, and into Posa, Zinja? Is this all right?
Well, mina ebu zaveni wami wonke ngibuswe umgabelo mnangagwa ngivele ngaya sikhulanga nabo asikhulanga nabo we don't share the same culture abalwazi uhlupho lwami they never stayed there so it's surprising really that people raise that as an issue
but at least they were Zimbabwean they were not
from well we do not have a Zimbabwean culture they don't speak my language they don't share my problems they didn't go through Kukulawuti so we are different. So I'm surprised that people really try to equalize this into and say simply because a person was born outside the borders, therefore they are qualified. As if Mugabe, so Mugabe was better qualified being a Zimbabwean, as if Ula then around that sense, okay, that's the qualification that you are, that's the good governance that you want. No. That is to use the simple word, utter nonsense. Really, it's not correct. Let me characterize this thing in the right way. When we are talking of culture, it's different from politics. We have political citizenship and cultural citizenship. That is why if you went to South Africa, the Swazi king is located in Swaziland. The Sotho king is located in Lesotho. You go to the northwestern South Africa, you find that the traditional leadership is across the borders. So culture does not recognize political borders. It doesn't. It just doesn't throughout the world. So if you really take political citizenship as a definition of culture, then you lose the meaning of everything. So you can share with me political citizenship, but still be a foreigner in my culture. And I cannot probably share political citizenship. With somebody, and that person will still be a citizen of my culture. So that is how it works. Ulilandlobengulakhumalo is never a foreigner in our culture, and we are raising our king in terms of our culture and not in terms of Zimbabwean citizenship. And that must be loud and clear. There are people that I share citizenship, political citizenship within Zimbabwe, but that are foreign in my culture, and I'm foreign to their culture.
So I'm expecting that this guy comes to Zimbabwe. I mean, if he agrees, how does he? I mean, assist government?
Well, let me address the issue of whether he agrees. The first time he came here, he was quite a kid, a preschool kid. And on an annual basis, he has always been visiting this country. His father did the same, his grandfather did the same, and his great-grandfather rose. Actually, they participated in the established So they have roots in this country. They are well established in this country. And they will definitely come. I mean, all of them, the offspring. But the Crown Prince, more importantly, will come and is going to be coronated on the 3rd of March 2018. He's going to be king and he's going to be resident here. He's definitely going to be resident here. That must be very clear. We are decolonizing our culture. That is very important. As much as others are going around the world looking for the Zimbabwean bird, and I know now there is a campaign to bring back the skull of Mbuyane Handa and so forth and so forth, we are bringing back live people that were taken away by colonialism from us. And he's going to be resident here, and we are going to take care of him in terms of our culture. And it's all up to government to decide what to do about it. But we don't fail to take care of our own. But naturally, you expect the government to play a role in terms of a resuscitated cultural institution. Because in terms of the current government policy, there has to be resuscitation of all cultural institutions that were demised by colonialism. And the kingship is an important heritage for us, is an important institution, cultural institution that we are resuscitating. And it was Zimbabwe after all. We as a government, that has to be understood.
We have basically seen the other groups that are also claiming to the throne, and we know that on the 7th of, on the 17th of February, that is, I think, this weekend, there will be an unveiling of the prince and all. So you guys are actually causing on an open over 7th of course. Are there any moves to talk to all these different groups so that, you come together?
Well, we desire unity more than anything else, and everything is going to be done to unite this nation behind a single king. And definitely at the end of the day, there is going to be a single, legitimate, and recognized king. There may be others that are claiming, and that is normal. There is always going to be such people around the world, but at the end of the day, you will end up having one legitimate and recognized king. And that king is going to be the current Crown Prince, Bulelani Khuma. There's no other person. Others, yes, they can claim there's no problem. They have legitimate expectations, probably being born in that. But at the end of the day, we have to sort that out by having a syndicate. And we're going to talk to every person. We're going to consolidate this strength that we have through reviving this institution.
Yeah, then if you're looking at the current energy system of governance, and all those kind of things. How does this person, the new king, fit in the current structure?
Well, before the advent of colonialism, the king was both head of state and head of government. He was the ultimate authority.
He
was the commander in chief as well. But now we are resuscitating the king in a new constitutional environment, with modern principles of governance, in terms of democratic institutions and principles. So obviously he has to fit into the modern standards that were established by the people. We are not raising a king, Lobemuna, a king, Zilgazi, or some Shaka, or that sort of a thing. It is a modernized monarchy. So he will fit above the ships. We are not resuscitating a ship. He's a king, His Majesty. That has to be understood. In terms of political ladder, the decision would be made by the people as they move on. But what is important is that we are reviving the office of His Majesty, not some chief, His Majesty. And he is going to be ranking way up there in terms of the ladder, not subject to any other institution except that which is established in terms of the constitution and the law. That is all.
So do you think the political leadership would really they accept such a setup, or you anticipate that they're going to find a lot of challenges?
Well, I'm a human rights defender. I have grown up in a situation where we fight for every right. We fight for the freedom of choice, fight for the freedom of expression of the media and everything. We will fight for the right to culturally express ourselves. This institution that we are reviving is recognized in terms of our rights by the Constitution. It provides very clear, expressly, that we, the people of Zimbabwe, citizens of Zimbabwe, have the right to freely express our cultural beliefs. And how do we do that? We revive the king, we revive the kingship, and we will fight every way for this right, like we do for every right. The right to get our children to school, to access medical treatment and all those things. In Zimbabwe, you have to struggle for every right, and this right is not going to be delivered to us on a silver platter. No, it's never going to be done that way. We are going to fight for it, and we are going to win at the end of the day.
Yeah, maybe lastly, take us through the process that will happen. I mean, we know you are already doing preparations. How are the preparations going?
Well, the preparations are going on very well. We are still going to do the coronation on the 3rd of March 2018. On that day, the Crown Prince becomes His Majesty the King, and he's going to be given a new crown name, not the one that he currently uses as the King. Basically, on that day, there is going to be some speeches basically around the history of the kingdom or the kingship itself, and then there's going to be the actual crowning. And then the king will make his inaugural speech, and then there's going to be other activities that will follow in terms of entertainment and the like. So it's going to be a celebratory environment where people are going to be celebrating their culture, the coming together, the coming back of that which was taken from us by colonialism. As I said, this very act is part of the liberation we fought for. We are completing, this is the completion of the liberation struggle that we started way back in 1893. In the absence of the king, we are still yet to be completely liberated in terms of the totality of the liberation that we wanted. So our activities for the day are going to be focused on that. And between now and that day, we are going to be focusing on letting the people know that the event is going to be taking place. We are going to be focusing on really tying the loose ends here and there to ensure that the day becomes a success. And definitely it is going to be a very huge success.
So who does the crown?
It's a decision that is going to be made by the Crown Council itself. But I can tell you the options that are out there. You can do the crowning yourself if you are authorized to do so by the people in authority. Any person can do so. It can be done by a minister of religion. It can be done by a king from outside the country. It can be done by a king if we have another king located within the country. It can be done by any person who is authorized to do so by the Crown Council. So I don't know, really the actual person who is going to be doing the actual crowning, but it is going to be that.
So I'm looking at this day that is almost, it politically, because Zimbabwe is so highly politically polarized, we have seen groups like, NPR, Travers, and all these other groups, and you also then have the people coming up with the king, and someone said, so these guys really now want to succeed. So are you involving the government authorities? Are they going to be there? Are we likely to see the head of state coming to welcome the meeting? What are the arrangements?
Well, as to whether the head of state comes in to welcome the new king, it's a decision he has to make himself. He has to make his political calculations. I cannot do that for him. But obviously, we have this open invitation to every person throughout the world in Zimbabwe, across cultures, across ethnic and racial groups in the country, across religions, that those who desire to participate in this can come. And the same invitation is extended to the president as the head of state and head of government. In terms of the political engagement with government, the chiefs don't forget an extension of government themselves. So when you have chiefs involved in anything, government is already involved. So you cannot say the chiefs and then government. The chiefs are government. They get a salary from government, and recently you saw they got cars from government. They are judicial officers of state. They hear cases at the lower level, and their judgments are recognized by the courts in Zimbabwe. They sit as peace officers. They have arrest powers. They have developmental activities that they are mandated by the constitution to do. So the issue of government being involved, the government is already involved through the chiefs. So the question might be, do we want the political part of government, the political departments of government to be actively involved? No, we don't want them to be actively involved, because for now it is a cultural phase. We are doing what we want to do in terms of our culture, and let the chiefs from that particular culture lead the process. And we are happy so far that that is happening. And it is up to government, the political departments of government, to play a role, one or two, in terms of their choices. But we have this open invitation. We have informed them that we, the people of this country, the citizens of this country, empowered by the Constitution, Chapter 4 and other provisions of the Constitution, are crowning a king on the 3rd of March 2018 in terms of the rights that are enshrined in the Constitution and the powers that are vested with the chiefs by the Constitution. So it's a decision that they have to make. We just informed them. We never went there and requested to enjoy our rights. That's not how these things work. You tell the person that, I know I have a right to do this, and I'm going to be doing this exactly the way it is written in the Constitution. Cultural rights are just as good as religious rights. Government can just pronounce itself by saying there shall be freedom of religion, but it cannot go on to say you will have the right to put a pope there, a bishop there, and so forth. And in this instance, the Constitution recognizes our rights to freely practice our culture, and in recognition of that right and the exercise of that right, we are putting the institution, the Romans will put their pope, we are putting our king. It's just as good as that.
I know there are a lot of issues and that keep on popping up and doing things. But my last question is, the state or the real estate as it was, 1816, they've changed. And we are bringing a king. How do we link up with all these other people? Or Sasa has told us that the spaghetti king and all those kind of things. Are we opening a Pandora's box, or we have consulted all these people and they are willing to say, okay, yeah, we don't have a woman, we can still live.
The two things that are important out of that, it is important that I must stress that the king ship that we are reviving is not in terms of what was existing there. As I say, it is in terms of the provisions of the current constitutional environment, not just within the country but internationally, in terms of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of the United Nations, the African Charter on Human and People's Rights. There is this general emphasis on the rights of the people across ethnic and racial boundaries. So we are not reviving a king to come back as King Lobemona. He is coming in a new dispensation where you have gender equality, where children have rights, where every ethnic and racial group has access to equal treatment and opportunities. So he is coming in not to be imposed on any linguistic or cultural group or any religious group. No, he is coming in as one of the many that may be resuscitated. If you have people in a particular community desiring to resuscitate a particular institution, I would gladly sit in this very couch as the CEO of the very institution again, okay? Because this is just a campaign to ensure that every person is recognized, the recognition of all the cultural rights. But should people volunteer to recognize him across the ethnic groups as king, he in turn has an obligation to ensure that he treats every person equally. He is going to be bound by the constitutional principles of this day. He will campaign to defend the Ndebele language, the Xhosa language, the Kalanda language, the Tonga language, every language. He will campaign to ensure that every person has access to a job in their community, that the public service is available in their language. He is not coming in to be sort of the Ndebele language king. He is coming in to be a king for all the people who accept and recognize him as king across races and ethnic groups.
Thank you very much. That was Effie Mube, the CEO of the Crown Council. We're talking about the installation of the king, and there's been a lot of debate and a lot of arguments, and we know that a lot of groups are actually claiming the crown. So as we go towards the day, we'll be talking to these comrades, and eventually we'll be able to cover all these events and see who emerges the king. So,